I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Yosi Yisraeli. He's a postdoctoral fellow here at the center. He's a postdoctoral fellow with Professor Dostoyevsky at the Department of General History in Bar-Ilan University. He graduated from Tel Aviv University under the supervision of Professor Jeremy Cohen, and he wrote about some of the high-profile conversos of Iberia, 14th and 15th century, gravitating around Pablo de Santa Maria. And his talk today, the title is right behind him, The Consolidation of Converso Ideology in the 15th Century, New Forms of Christian Knowledge, and Yosi, with no further ado.
Thank you, Effie. Okay, so as first of all, welcome to the 13th in December. But beyond of that, about the title, as the things go often, you have the title and then you work through the actual talk, and there isn't certainly a perfect match, but you'll see. Only the first half, the consolidation of Converso ideology, maybe in the 15th century, and maybe in the end we'll speak more about the dissemination of these new forms of Christian knowledge, which is my current project. So let me begin. In the 16th century saw the transformation of Christian Hebraism from a narrow and limited medieval form of knowledge into a central intellectual trend that encompassed many disciplinary branches, was practiced in almost all universities, and captivated the minds of Christian intellectual elite. This rise of new Christian exploration of the Hebrew scripture, Jewish history of the church, and rabbinic secrets has often been associated with the increasing appraisal of the studia humanitatis, with its historical philological sensitivities on the one hand, and the growing allure of the prisca theologica on the other. And indeed, the importance of these intellectual trends to the development of Christian Hebraism cannot be overstated. However, today in this talk, I would like to point at another historical and intellectual scene that might have played a crucial role in changing the course of Christian interests and attitudes towards its Jewish origins: the mass conversion crisis in the Iberian Peninsula and the consolidation of a converso ideologies or doctrines. As we know, the mass conversion of 1391 marked the beginning of a new phase in Jewish-Christian relations in the Iberian Peninsula, then the richest and biggest center of Jewish culture. For the first time since antiquity and 13th century Sicily, if we have to pay due to Nadia, three religious communities of Jews, Christians, and new Christians or conversos were living side by side. While officially and legally the conversos transformed from Jews into Christians overnight, becoming equal members in the church and gaining all the social, legal, and economic rights that were deprived from them as Jews, in social and cultural terms, their transformation was much less evident. They often kept close business and social ties with their remaining Jewish friends and family. They had all sorts of habits that were considered distinctively Jewish, and regardless of their beliefs, they knew very little, if at all, about their new religion. It was in these circumstances that the frenzy of suspicion over the Jewishness of conversos emerged, steering all the new anxieties from all the new Christian anxieties from the Jewish danger, and eventually leading to the creation of new mechanisms of segregation, discrimination, exclusion against both Jews and converts. For many years, historians looked at these events through the prism of a clash between fixed forms of Jewish and Christian religious identities, thus reiterating their sources in their quest to determine whether the converts were really Christians or Jews. In more recent years, however, historians have broadened their perspectives, recognizing that in this intensive process, the basic categories themselves of Jewishness and Christianness were recreated. The most influential representative of this approach, David Nirenberg, who was here last week and present last year, of course, was able to show that it was in these particular circumstances that notions of blood and race became dominant factors in determining religious identities. Instead of just searching for the origins of racist or genealogical notions in Jewish and Christian traditions, he showed that these ideas were elevated in a dynamical process that involved all the three groups, who were redefining their identities against each other amid the collapse of their former boundaries. The premise of my study, however, is that is that notions of genealogy, blood, and race were not the only products that emerged from this process of redefining the Jewish, Christian, and Converso identities. Competing ideas, mostly theological, that intended to reconcile Jewish elements within Christian identities and vice versa, were also developed along these years, challenging the exclusive meaning of Jewishness and Christianness. And that is generally the framework of this kind of amorphic term that I'm still using and thinking about, which is with Converso ideology, that for now mostly mark not an ideology that was held by all Conversos or exclusively by Conversos, but an ideology or doctrines that were developed in the context of the Converso crisis. In the political context of the Iberian Peninsula, these ideas were eventually repressed and rejected, and by the end of the 15th century, almost any sign of Jewishness would be interpreted as anti-Christian, leading to the expulsion of the Jews and the persecution of the converts. But this does not mean that these notions of Converso doctrine did not find their way into other disciplinary frameworks, producing a new form of knowledge, and particularly what I'm studying, Christian knowledge. So in the coming hour and a half or so, I would like to present the general, what is actually the first step of my ongoing study, by focusing on two prominent and rivaling Converso scholars of the first generation, Profia Duran and Pablo de Santa Maria, whom, as Efin mentioned, was the main subject of my dissertation. By reading several of their texts, I hope to demonstrate how did their struggle to construct their very different religious identities and to reconcile within its Jewish and Christian component, and to reconcile within it Jewish and Christian components, led them to produce new forms of critical thinking about their own scholarly traditions, calling for their reform of both Jewish and Christian traditions. Okay, so we'll start with Duran. Profia Duran, or Rabbi Yitzchak ben Moshe Alevi, was born around 1350 in Perpignan, that was then part of the Kingdom of Aragon. He was a financier, a physician, an astronomer, and a very close friend to the famous Crescas family, in which household he also served as a tutor at one point. But maybe most importantly, he was also one of the most prolific writers and original thinkers, or is considered to be one of these Jewish prolific writers and original thinkers of this time, leaving us more than 20 Hebrew works of different sizes. Many of them, some of them have won tremendous popularity, recopied in dozens and dozens of manuscripts, and others are still lying today in single manuscripts in several archives. These works spread over a variety of disciplinary fields, from astronomy to philosophy and historiography, grammar, biblical commentaries, illustrating the wide intellectual horizons that characterized his circle of Aragonese and North Castilian scholars, whom almost all of them provided some financial or scientific services in royal courts and combined the study of philosophy with a strong sense of pride in their Hebraic heritage and linguistic proficiencies. But what is most remarkable when you look at this group of works that he composed is that a large portion of those, at least those that we can date, were written when Duran was actually already a Christian. If until several years ago, some historians could have still raised suspicions, today, after further archival material was recovered from different, it is beyond doubt that Profia Duran was baptized to Christianity in the early 1390s, probably during the riots of 1391, and took the name Honoratus de Bona Fide, and remained a Christian for the rest of his life, or until at least a very old age. We know that he traveled a lot during those years, when he was a convert, but also that he lended his services as an astronomer and physician in royal and ecclesiastical courts. And it was during these years that he adopted his new pen name, Ephod, an acronym of his Hebrew name, Ani Profia Duan, under which he would continue to write in Hebrew to his Jewish and Converso audience. Now, clearly, we may learn from this alone despite of his baptism, Duran never stopped seeing himself as a part of the Jewish people, and the part of the thriving Sephardic Republic of Letters. But it is important to remember that while the general idea that converts can remain a part of Israel was not new, it was also far from obvious that a person as Duran could simply continue to conduct himself as part of the Jewish intellectual and spiritual elite while still comfortably living as a Christian in every public sphere. In fact, two other options could have been much more lauded than expected from someone of his position. One, as Maimonides recommended, was to flee the kingdom and to return to your Judaism in a safe territory, which indeed a lot of converts did these years in North Africa, as for example Rabbi Yitzchak Bar Sheshet, who also converted in 1391. The second was to choose a martyr's death. Now, Ram is not here, but as Ram Ben Shalom showed in his important study, the notion of martyr's death was very relevant in these years for these Sephardic scholars, and specifically to the circle in which Duran lived, that in which several of his colleagues acquaintances indeed chose this option. If Duran, nevertheless, preferred to take a different course as a convert and continue to live as a Christian, it was up to him to articulate the Jewish legitimacy of his new identity. So how did Duran explain to himself and to his Jewish colleagues his new converso identity? We can find a part of the answer in a eulogy that Duran wrote for Avraham Bar Yitzchak Halevi of Gerona, probably in 1393. In this public letter, Duran reflected on the events of 1391, their reasons, and the fate of the converts. He began his discussion by glorifying those who chose martyrs' death as the saviors and protectors of the nation. But then he goes on to explain that those who succumbed to the riots and fears and converted as himself are also still part of the nation. Reading through the relevant biblical passages, he points that both in the Egyptian and Babylonian captivities, many have failed and began worshipping idols, the local idols. However, in both cases, these apostates were included in the seed of Abraham when the time of redemption came, and returned with the rest of Israel to the promised land. Therefore, he concluded, the same will also occur in the current exile, pointing at a specific verse from the Song of Moses, Deuteronomy 32, that predicts the redemption of converts together with Israel when they return to the promised land. He continues to explain, however, the nature of this bond that ties Israel and converts together, by turning to a metaphor of a tree and its seed that Yehuda HaLevi used in the Book of Kuzari. The metaphor tells of a grain or a seed that falls from a tree to the ground. At the beginning, it looks to an observer that the seed is observed in the elements of the earth and the waters that surrounds it, and that it is completely lost in the ground. But in practice, since the seed has a special quality in it, what happens over time is that the seed only loses its husk, and then changes the elements that surround him, the earth and the water, into his own kind, growing up a new tree that gives fruit like the fruit that he came from. Now, Yehuda HaLevi used this parable in order to explain the function of Israel and the Torah in exile among the nations, pointing at the benefit that may grow from their captivity, drawing the nations to God. But Duran reads this parable specifically on converts, comparing them to the seemingly lost seed and its special divine qualities. And this is the first text that you have in the handout. You can read it either from here or in the handout. And this, that means the parable, also applies to us, who inherited the complete Torah, for we will not genuinely transform into other than ourselves. Only that which appears as the husk will transform, while the heart, the unique quality and the divine faculty, shall remain potent even though it may seem lost and altered. Just as with the seed, other nations will return into our own faith, revealing the divine faculty. And to this the prophet hinted when he said about the future redemption that as the earth brings forth its shoot, etc., from Isaiah 61. Thus, Duran is rereading images and mechanisms of divine providence that were once used or understood generally with regard to Israel in exile as referring specifically to the identity of converts as himself. Using the image of a tree and its seed, and referring to the special divine quality that transmits through generation, Duran stressed the genealogical element in this bond between Israel and converts. And it can be considered as another example of how the genealogical mentality indeed developed in these circumstances. However, through this parable, Duran did not only reapprove the belonging of converts to Israel and their eventual salvation, but went a step further, implying in quite clear terms that converts as himself have a vital function in this history of salvation as some kind of transformers of their Gentile surrounding. Now, against the inclusive elements of genealogy and divine election, there was, of course, another important pillar of Jewish identity which converts as Duran could no longer proclaim, and that was, of course, the practice of the commandments. And this could, of course, endanger and threaten their legitimate stand as Jews. It is in this context, I believe, that Duran repeatedly stressed in this very same eulogy that one of the reasons that caused the disaster of 1391 and the mass conversion was that all of the nation's effort were devoted to the deed alone without any intention next to it. And he repeats this message several times, that the nation, that the leaders of the nation, referring to the Talmudists through the parable of Maimonides on the sack that walks around the house, are only preoccupied with the deed and thus neglect the real intention. So as we take into account that Duran is writing from a position of a convert and not simply as a Jew who can no longer practice any of these outer deeds, this internal criticism can also be read as part of his apologetic strategy of minimizing the role of external practices and ceremonies that he can no longer perform and shifting the focus to the inner intentions. For as Duran himself admits when he signs the eulogy, his deeds are now alien and he worshipped foreign practices. In his own words, he writes about himself, "Zar ma'asehu nochriya avodato," and these are the terms that he constantly try to minimize their significance, the ma'aseh and the avodah. Thus minimizing the significance and importance of the deed, the ma'aseh, was becoming crucial for determining the Jewishness of Duran's new status as a Christian. But as Duran would also soon find out, the challenges facing the legitimacy of his Jewish identity as a convert were even more complex. Apparently, his ability to claim that his baptism and negligence of the commandments did not prevent him from being a part of Israel was endangered by the behaviors of other converts from his close circle, who were much more lenient and even enthusiastic to embrace their new Christian identity. Thus, it was not simply enough to stress the bonds and mechanisms that tied converts to Israel, but it was also necessary to draw the outer boundaries of this inclusive Jewish converso identity, beyond which these ties were broken. This, to my understanding, is exactly what Duran was doing in his famous polemical letter known as Be Not Like Your Fathers. Now, Duran wrote this letter as a reply to a friend by the name David Bonnet Bonjon, who was also baptized to Christianity. However, somewhere along the way, Bonnet was persuaded by the famous convert from Burgos, Pablo de Santa Maria, to accept the truth of Christianity. Duran's response presented a sarcastic polemic against Christianity, mocking its irrational and anti-philosophical character, and it is considered as one of the most masterly crafted and pungent anti-Christian polemics. However, as we consider the converso context of the letter, we can see that next to the philosophical argumentation, Duran says here also something about the different identities of converts and their belonging to Israel. And this is how he begins the letter, that's the second text. I have read it, that is your letter that you sent me, in humility and muttering voice. Only little of it mysteries I obtained. But what I did understand for the most part was that your fathers inherited lies, that they followed the absurdity in their copious inquiries, their sense was lost, their wisdom vanished, their hope was in vain, and their salvation was a lie. They thought to ascend to heaven, and by their folly descended into the depths of Sheol. They were the ones who sinned in their souls. In their stupidity, all they were striving for turned into a lie, and they bore the shame. Now, of course, he writes this sarcastically to his friend, depicting his friend's new belief, as if that is what a convert who adopts Christianity actually says about his fathers. Now, in the same spirit, Duran continues throughout the letter to cover his philosophical argumentation with the accusation that converts as Bonnet and Pablo were betraying their fathers and heritage. And he concluded the letter by saying that such converts should never mention their father's name, for surely their fathers, now mourning in their graves, would prefer having no sons at all. So even the eulogy, Duran labored to show how converts as himself were still a part of Israel and its future salvation and its covenant with God, even though they were baptized and now lived as Christian. In Be Not Like Your Fathers, he was drawing the outer boundary of that identity. For without such a boundary, there was nothing setting him apart from converts as Bonnet and Pablo, who publicly professed and claimed the true Christian beliefs. If Duran was to convince his Jewish colleagues that he still belonged in Israel, despite his baptism, such a distinction had to be made. Now, I would argue that it was exactly this thin line that Duran had to walk as a convert that shaped also his two most popular works, scientific works or philosophical works, Maaseh Ephod and the Disgrace of the Gentiles, in which he harshly criticized both Jewish and Christian scholarly traditions. In his introduction to the grammar book Maaseh Ephod that he composed in 1403, Duran called for a comprehensive reform in Jewish scholarship and practices. He began by introducing the three schools of thought that dominated the Jewish world of his time: the philosophers, the Kabbalists, and the Talmudists. While he acknowledged that each of these disciplines had some value and importance, he nevertheless claimed that each of them suffered from disadvantages and failures that made them insufficient or inadequate to constitute the main field of practice of a Jewish scholar. Against these schools, he then posed his own alternative, a fourth discipline that would focus solely on the wisdom of the Torah itself, cherishing it, constantly studying it, fully understanding and memorizing it. Thus, against the preoccupation with the Talmud, with philosophy and Kabbalah that characterized the Jewish world, according to Duran, it is the study of the Torah that enables the complete fulfillment of Jewish life. It has the power, that is, that study that he is suggesting and depicting, to achieve both the spiritual and temporal goals of the individual and the individual believer, and it is also the most important element in shaping the collective fate of the nation and its relation with God. As Duran explains, this intense preoccupation with scriptures rested on two pillars, that they were the actual practices that he tried to promote. The first was profound linguistic proficiency and meticulous scientific inquiry into the meaning of the biblical text. In this regard, he was calling for a revival of the Andalusian biblical tradition, or at least how it was imagined, that cherished the study of the Pshat instead of the Drash, and was criticizing the kind of midrashic interpretations that were coming, as he identified it from Rashi and other scholars in France and Ashkenaz. And to this exact purpose, he designed his own grammar guide. The second pillar was devotional, and it included contemplation and prayers that were focused only on the biblical text, especially on Psalms, and required the believer to meditate on the Torah for long period of hours each day. Now, as Duran further explain, since the scriptures replaced the temple as the source and the reason for the dwelling of the divine presence among Israel, so does the study of the Torah that he promotes replace the offering of the sacrifices in the temple. The entire existence of Israel was dependent on the renewal of these practices that he now promoted. For as was proved again and again everywhere, and he gives these examples, everywhere that the Jews became too lazy, as he says, so as he said it, to read the Bible properly, disaster followed. This was the case in France and Ashkenaz, where the famous expulsions and riots were the result of the complete negligence of the Torah. And of course, this disease, as he calls it, was now spreading into Spain and creating the current tragedies that he and the other Jews were experiencing. Now, obviously, the field of Biblicism that Duran was now advocating as the highest and purest of all Jewish disciplines was also the most accessible for converts as himself to follow, allowing them to take part in Jewish spirituality, serving as kinds of priests in the temple without observing Jewish commandments or dealing with rabbinic literature that could endanger them in their Christian surroundings. I believe that Duran himself was alluding to this cross-confessional nature of his biblicist approach when he presented in his introduction, one next to the other, the Talmudist negligence of the Torah and the Christian devotion to scriptures. According to Duran, the fixation of the Talmudists with halachic sophistry and dialectics, which brought them to divide each question into thousands and tens of thousands of irrelevant issues, bear the responsibility for the neglect of the Torah and for the dwindling of the Jewish spirituality scholarship. And again, he notes it was most visible in France and Ashkenaz. But against this negative portrayal of Talmudic studies, Duran invoked the following example of biblical devotion. Behold, for the other nations that translated our holy books also believe in this importance of the Torah. And you can find that a great wise man among the Christians, a pious of this nation, tells that when he began to study the books of the philosophers, a man appeared to him in his dream and began beating him ferociously. And when he asked, why does he beat him without any cause, the beater told him that he was ordered by God to do so because the wise man became lazy in his labor over the holy books, and he was drawn after the books of the philosophers. And so he ordered him that if he wishes to save himself, he should beware not to allow his mind to drift to other disciplines, but always keep studying the scripture as God desired. And this man, who established for the Christians the persistent reading in the books of Psalms and in their prayers, turning this book into their foundation. And this is the man who established for the Christian the persistent reading in the book of Psalms, in their prayers, turning this book into their foundation. Now, the story of the wise Christian man that Duran recounts here is, of course, the dream of Saint Jerome that became in the Christian world a symbol of his piety and scholarship. Some historians who read this passage have marveled at the intimate knowledge and respect the Jewish scholars of this generation had toward the Christian learning. However, if we read this passage in the Converso context, I'm suggesting that it becomes a vindication of the possibilities open before Christian converts to practice the kind of Biblicism that Duran advocated as a form of Judaism. Okay, but while Duran might have appreciated Jerome's devotion to scripture, he certainly did not think very highly of his level of biblical scholarship. Now that he knew it, up close as a convert. In fact, in his second book that I want to introduce, The Disgrace of the Gentiles, he applies his linguistic and biblical proficiencies in order to formulate a new devastating criticism of Christian history, beliefs, and scholarship. Along the 12th chapter of this treaty, The Disgrace of the Gentiles, Duran promoted two basic arguments. One, that Christian beliefs and practices of his own days completely distorted the intentions of Jesus and the apostles. Jesus and his disciples were pious Jewish fools, whom out of ignorance and enthusiasm often erred, and therefore Duran called them the mistaken. Yet they never had in mind anything that resembles the Christian orthodoxy that their much cleverer followers later developed, and to whom Duran refers as the misleaders. Thus, going through the entire New Testament, Duran was able to extract and quote passages that show that neither Jesus nor his first disciple thought that he was God, that he atoned for the original sin, or that he aimed to abolish and replace the laws of Moses. To the contrary, Paul and several of the other of the disciples strive to convert the Gentiles into Judaism. Likewise, he claimed that they never spoke of the Trinity, but simply mixed up erroneous Kabbalistic notions of the Sefirot, and that what later Christians took to be the sacraments of the Eucharist and baptism were merely descriptions of the common Jewish practices of the Seder and the immersion of Gerim. All these Christian principles were invented by later generations. And I think you can read this example in the meantime. I skipped it in order to meet the time, but this is where he explains the notion of baptism as kind as based on the Talmudic notion, on rabbinic notion of Tvilat Gerim. Okay, now to his second argument. Duran claimed that the Christian scriptures was filled with textual inaccuracies and distortions. Of course, this was something the Jews were claiming for centuries. But Duran had the ability to prove this through a systematic reading of the Christian scriptures. To begin with, he showed that in the New Testament, Jesus and his apostles often misquoted the prophecies and stories of the Old Testament. He lists about 80 such mistakes and concludes from them that these ignorant people must have known the Torah only through the sermons that they were hearing on Saturdays, and thus got a lot of things mixed up. But moreover, even the Old Testament that Christians read is filled with errors and mistake, for it was translated to Latin by Jerome to now he refers as Jerome the Distorter, that made countless mistakes. Few of them were made in purpose, but most of them resulted from his very poor Hebrew, which made him dependent on other ignorant Jews that were willing to assist him. Okay, so this text, the disgrace of the Gentile, is also a very well known work that served historians to discuss the development of Jewish religious polemics and historiographical sensitivities. But what I would like to stress here again is that Duran's new criticism of Christianity was not simply the fruit of Jewish polemical effort to combat conversions, but also the direct result of Duran's new knowledge of Christianity that he attained precisely because he was a convert who was living among Christians and probably taking part in many of their practices. In the case of Duran, who was struggling to prove his own Jewish fidelity, this new knowledge was translated into Jewish terms and into a Hebrew polemic against Christianity. However, it could, and it did also translate into new Christian terms and into new Christian knowledge about the history of the church and its own origins. And on this note, I would like to turn to the second figure, to the person who Duran describes in Be Not Like Your Father as his arch rival, the famous convert from Burgos, Pablo de Santa Maria. Pablo, or Shlomo Alevi, was born in Burgos to a family that came from Aragon in 1315. He was born in 1359 to 1352 to a family that came from Aragon, which makes him about the same age of Duran. We can learn from new Hebrew letters that survived that he was one of the leaders of the local community, that he provided some services to royal court, and that he was considered an exceptional biblical scholar who was well familiar also with the Christian writings. He wrote poems in Hebrew and stood in close personal contact with some of the most prominent Jewish figures of the time. Thus, when Pablo converted in the early 1390s, together with his family, in circumstances that are still unclear, he was already like Duran, an established Jewish scholar of the highest ranks. But whatever were his initial motivations or motives, there could be no doubt that after his baptism, Pablo soon became a devoted, sincere, and faithful Christian. Almost immediately, he joined the ranks of priesthood and set out to acquire formal theological education at the University of Paris. From this point onward, his Christian career skyrocketed, as he left tremendous impression as a scholar and administrator on his Christian colleagues and patrons. He became one of the closest advisor and personal delegate to Pope or Antipope Benedict XIII of Avignon. Later, then acquiring a series of ecclesiastical positions, eventually becoming the Bishop of Cartagena in 1403 and the Bishop of Burgos, his own hometown, in 1415. At the same time, he also became an important figure in the court of Enrique III and Juan II of Castile, serving as arch-chancellor and for a short period, even as one of the four acting regents of Castile who replaced Ferdinand when he was crowned the King of Aragon. Now, in both Jewish and in Hispanic historiography, Pablo has been often described as a cruel and sinister persecutor of his own people, serving as a symbol of apostate zealotry. When one of the main sources supporting this notion, or at least its origin, was actually Duran's letter, "Be not like your father." Although there is no concrete evidence to support this, he is also held responsible to the severe anti-Jewish measures that Christian authorities enacted during the years of his influence in the courts. Yet, his two massive theological tractates tell a very different story about how Pablo perceived his religious transformation. And the two works that I'm referring to are his enormous collection of biblical commentaries that were written in the forms of additions to the commentary of Nicholas de Lyra, the Postilla Literalis, usually dated to 1429, though probably combined of commentaries that he wrote who he wrote much earlier. And the second was the extensive polemical tractate known by the name the Scrutinium Scripturarum, the Scrutiny of the Scriptures, that include both a Jewish-Christian dialogue and an inner Christian dialogue between a new convert and his Christian teacher, which of course leads eventually to the complete acceptance of Christian beliefs by Jews and converts. Now, in both these works, Pablo proves himself to be a passionate and erudite Christian who admired Thomas Aquinas and believed that Christian spirituality was the only answer to the ills of radical philosophy which corrupted Judaism of his time. However, at the same time, it is also clear that Pablo never thought of his own conversion as an act of complete cut-off from his former Jewish identity as an Israelite or even as a Levite. To the contrary, he thought of his position as a faithful Christian as derived specifically from his continuous belonging to Israel, and of his position as a priest as the ultimate fulfillment of his Levite origins. And in this basic sense, we can see that he and Duran faced somewhat similar challenges vis-a-vis the different communities they were addressing. Duran had to define a Judaism that would tolerate and allow his new Christianness after he was baptized, while Pablo had to persuasively articulate a Christianity that would accept and tolerate the components of his former Jewish identity. And indeed, like Duran, Pablo secured his Israelite identity within the church through the ideas of history of salvation, but of course, Christian salvation. He discussed these matters in several places, trying to show that the people of Israel had always been and would always be at the center of God's vehicle of human redemption, that is, the church. We can sum up his plan in the following points. One, the establishment of the church did not mark the rejection of Israel, but rather the materialization of its covenant with God and its promise for salvation. For it was Israel that established the primitive church, becoming the spiritual root that nourished the new congregation. Two, It was through the church that Israel mediated its spiritual gifts to the other nations, thus elevating and inviting them to share its own dignity and divine qualities. These divine gifts include the Torah, the Messiah, and the Holy Spirit. And three, Israel never ceased to play a crucial role in the Christian history of salvation, even after the establishment of the church, since it continued to provide a stream of converts that was small in number but of great importance, vitalizing the Christian faith. Paul the Apostle, Stephen the First Martyr, these are the names that he counts on two occasions in his, when he discusses these issues. Paul the Apostle, Stephen the Martyr, Pope Evaristus, Julian of Toledo, Petrus Alfonsi, and Abner of Burgos were all examples of Jewish converts who enriched and developed the church through writings and teachings that no other Christian could produce. And fourth, the church will fulfill its destiny at the end of days when all the Jews will convert and Israel will serve as the main force at Christ's side. Now, Pablo often based these conclusions on the same prophecies and images as Duran, most notably the Song of Moses, Isaiah 29, and the biblical metaphors of an olive tree and its fruit. Of course, in the case of Pablo, referring to the one in the Epistle to the Romans and to the one in Jeremiah 17, which Pablo believed was the biblical text on which Paul the Apostle was commenting when he wrote his olive tree parable in Romans 11. Of course, he never thought that Israel's redemption would materialize through its return to the promised land, but only through the church. But still, what is important to stress is that Pablo, like Duran and unlike his Christian contemporaries, was reading certain biblical prophecies and promises as pertaining specifically to Israel of both the spirit and the flesh, that is, Israelite who joined the church or Jewish converts. In this sense, Duran and Pablo were sharing at certain points a common hermeneutical approach to scripture, as well as the perception that Israel constituted a transconfessional category that could operate both outside and inside the church. In such context, of course, the Israelite origins of Jewish converts, this is from the perspective of Pablo, became source of pride and virtue and could continue to play function in the new identity of converts as Christians. The Jewish converts were the active agents of Israel in the church and in its history of salvation. And the fact that Pablo counseled together Paul the Apostle together with modern converts as Petrus Alfonsi and Abner of Burgos is kind of astounding, because he, of course, by this give people, and there's no doubt he's thinking about himself when he speaks about this person, he's putting himself in the same kind of category. Paul the Apostle, the composer of the most important part of Christian scriptures, as describing it as part of a converso contribution to Christianity, a later converso contribution to the gospel of Jesus. So now he puts himself and other modern converts in that same pile. And of course, this illustrates how central were these converts in the spiritual growth of the church. And I also believe that on this background, we can also better understand the point that Duran was trying to make so passionately in Be Not Like Your Fathers. The reason that it was so important for him to stress that converts like Pablo, that we now just seen his belief, who truly accepted Christian faith, has lost all ties with Israel, was precisely because it was not self-evident to them, and they were claiming and trying to convince other converts that it was not the case. That is, that you can be a faithful Christian and still not lose all your ties to Israel and to that sense of Jewishness. Okay. Now I move to the issue of scholarship in the case of Pablo. But Pablo's efforts to establish the role of converts and their Jewish heritage in the church did not resort only on notions of elections and ancestral merits, but also on scholarly expertise. For despite of Pablo's admiration towards Christian devotional practices and spirituality, his works embody a harsh criticism of certain Christian disciplines, and particularly biblical scholarship. Naturally, this criticism was best laid out in his biblical commentaries, the Additiones. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the Additiones were compiled as supplements to the most popular and authoritative literal commentary of the late Middle Ages, the Postilla of Nicholas de Lyra. Who was considered the undisputed champion of the literal sense and also the highest authority on issues pertaining to the Hebraica Veritas, to the Hebrew Bible. But Pablo's editions were not just innocent supplements to Lyra's commentaries, but more of a relentless and continuous polemic against Lyra's proclaimed expertise that Christians admired. In his prologue, Pablo tells of several failures that he found in the Postilla that could not leave him indifferent. One of them was although Lyra often turned to the Hebrew language, he did not possess sufficient knowledge of it, like those who learned it from childhood. He only had some familiarity with it as someone who in old age thought the opinion of others. So, according to Pablo, the greatest Christian authority of the Hebrew Bible simply did not know Hebrew, but only scattered the opinions of others. And of course, you can note that Pablo stresses here the issue of knowing Hebrew as a quality that needs studying from early age, from childhood, which can of course refer only to Jews or converts who later converted. Another failure that Pablo counts regards Lyra's dependencies on Rashi's commentaries. As Pablo explained, Rashi was appreciated by the Jews only as a Talmudist, but not as a grammarian or as a literalist. And thus, not only that Lyra himself did not know Hebrew, but when he drew on the opinions of the Jews, he was repeating Rashi's Talmudic fables instead of consulting real Jewish experts on the scriptures as Ibn Ezra and Achmanides, of course part of the same Andalusian biblical tradition that Duran was talking as well as an alternative to the system of studying the Torah through the Talmudic Midrash of Rashi and his followers. According to these principles, along the Additiones, Pablo constantly overruled Lyra's opinion regarding the Hebraica Veritas with dismissive comments like, "This would be evident to anyone who has any knowledge of this language," that left no doubt in reader's mind that Lyra simply did not know Hebrew. Importantly, however, while Pablo aimed all his rhetorical arrows at Lyra, it often became clear that his criticism targeted the Latin translation of the Vulgate. For example, see what Pablo writes in his commentary to Exodus 2. In the Vulgate, verse 21 of this chapter reads, "And Moses swore that he will dwell with Yitro." Consequently, in the Postilla, Lyra struggled to explain the nature of Moses' oath. But in his addition to this commentary, Pablo argued against Lyra that his explanation was completely useless, since no oath is admitted in the original Hebrew, in the original Hebrew verse that reads, "Vayoel Moshe Lashevet et Aish." So the question is here, what is Vayoel? And this is how he explains. The Hebrew word Vayoel appears frequently in the scriptures. Sometimes it is translated to Latin as to begin, as in Genesis 18, and in Deuteronomy 1st, and at other times it is translated as to swear, as in this passage, and in the books of Kings. However, according to the Hebrew truth, this word is unequivocal, and never means, whenever it is written, anything apart from a voluntary deed. And therefore, in this instance, nothing else could be said besides that Moses wished to dwell with that man, that is, with the Yitro, and nowhere in scriptures an oath is admitted. Okay, so even though rhetorically Pablo presented his claims against Lyra's explanation of the text of the oath, it is virtually impossible to read this short edition as anything but a brutal critique of Jerome, who continuously mistranslated in the Vulgate the Hebrew verb leoil into a myriad of erroneous meanings. To make things worse, Pablo stressed that it was a rather common Hebrew word that should pose no semantic difficulty, as it had only one possible meaning. Through about such 250 corrections that Pablo makes in his biblical commentaries to the text, some of them pertaining to crucial passages in Christian theology, he was able to put the entire Latin translation of the Vulgate into question. So, what I think we can see if we compare what Duran does and what Pablo does, that there isn't really much of a difference. Maybe a little bit in rhetoric, Pablo of course will never refer to Jerome as Jerome the Distorter. But if you look at the kind of corrections, the kind of mistakes that Duran find in the Old Testament, and what Pablo goes later on to do, and in what language and in what methods he shows the deficiencies of the translation itself and of Christian scholarship, you see that we have here actually the same kind of enterprise, but only one place, in one channel in Hebrew for Jewish audience as an anti-Christian polemic, and in the second channel that Pablo uses as kind of an inner Christian self-critique about these same issues. Okay, but as one reads Pablo's work, it becomes clear that Christian scholarship did not only suffer from its poor linguistic abilities that kept many treasures of the Hebrew Bible hidden from it. It also suffered from a serious lacuna in its historical self-perception, as it overlooked the existence of ancient rabbinic traditions. Of course, Christians have known the Talmud since the 12th century and have been using extracts from it in order to prove the principles of Christianity from the middle of the 13th century. But for different reasons that we'll not get into now, Christians have never considered the Talmud or its traditions as integral part of their own scholarly and spiritual heritage. In fact, they have repeatedly condemned it as heretic and even satanic creation that was invented 400 years after Christ in order to combat Christianity. But according to Pablo, by taking this position, Christians were giving away a corpus of sources that contained invaluable information on the origins of the church. He addressed this issue explicitly at the beginning of his polemical dialogue, the Scrutinium Scripturarum, where he explained what Jesus meant when he had told in John 5:39, "Search the Scripture, scrutamini Scripturas," from this derive, of course, the title of the work, for they testify on my behalf. Now, Christian readers of the Middle Ages had no doubt that when Jesus spoke of Scriptures, he was referring to the Old Testament. But Pablo asked to expand the meaning of Scripture, and including it also the glosses or the writings of their Talmudists that the Jews thought to be authentic. Pablo mentioned two reasons why Jesus would instruct to explore the writing of the rabbis. First, because it was polemically effective. And second, because the rabbis tend to unconsciously prophesize about issues referring to the salvation of humanity, that is, of course, Christianity, and that can be very benefit to Christians. But what was most problematic and potentially explosive in Pablo's reading was the implication that Jewish rabbinic literature was integral to the cultural and religious context in which Jesus lived and preached. This notion ran counter to the common Christian claim about the Talmud, as Pablo himself explained. This is in the. This is how he proceeds his explanation of the verse from John, "Scrutamini Scripturas." "And if it would be argued against me that the writings of the Talmudists and others had not yet been composed in the time of Christ, it should be answered that it is true only with regard to the modus in which they were presently presently compiled and arranged in books. For in fact, they had been written a long time before, presented as apocryphal, and only later compiled, attached, and rendered into these familiar books. Just as among us Christians, Gratian compiled the decrees and sayings of the saints that had been given a long time before of him." Thus, Pablo defends his stand that rabbinic teachings were indeed part of the world from which Christianity emerged by drawing a distinction between the books of the Talmud that were a late compilation and the teachings it included, which originated in different times and were of different authority. Thus, while the Talmud as a book indeed contained defiled and even demonic teachings, it also preserved ancient traditions that predated Jesus and can be used for the study of scripture. Interestingly, Duran makes a very similar argument in his grammar book, in the introduction to his grammar book, Masseh Efod, when he criticized the Talmudists who didn't understand the difference between the principles of the Talmud as a tool for studying the Torah and the entire book of the Talmud. And this is what he wrote in Profia Duran in his introduction. The wisdom of the Talmud is not equal to everything that the book of the Talmud contains. For if it was so, what were the merits of David, Solomon, and all the wise men of Israel who lived before the book was edited? Do you think that the wisdom of Solomon included this book that was written more than 1300 years afterwards? It was told on Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, who lived before the destruction of the temple, that he always studied scriptures, Mishnah and Talmud, even though this book was composed more than 1400 years after the destruction of the temple. Thus, both Pablo and Duran attempted to deconstruct the Talmud in order to justify their new model of studying the scriptures as Christians. In Duran's case, it served his claim, addressing Jewish ears, that his model of studying Torah included the real wisdom of the Talmud that he now could no longer profess. And in Pablo's case, it was intended to validate the antiquity and authenticity of some rabbinic teachings in order to make them a legitimate part of his Christian scholarship of scripture. And as we read his biblical commentaries, we see that this is exactly what he does along them. So I brought you one example out of many. That is taken from Pablo's commentary on Psalm 112, that is Tehilim Kuf Yud Gimel. And this is how he begins a very long edition that I only gave opening passage. This psalm, together with the following five psalms, are called by the Jews the Great Hallel. It serves as a single great hymn in time of observance, as in the three special festivals and the beginning of the month. Furthermore, during the night of the Passover, when the lamb of the Passover had been eaten, they chanted this hymn as they sat at the table after the lamb has been eaten. Israel. From this we may learn that the word said in Matthew 26, prior to the Passion, after the hymn was sung, yes, and now he's referring to the story of the late supper, the tales of the late supper, and then before Jesus and his disciples leaves to
last.
And what did they say?
Late.
Yeah. Of course, the last supper, not the late supper. So the Vulgate says after the hymn was sung, they left. And so this is what he's referring. From this we may learn that the words said in Matthew prior to the Passion, after the hymn was sung, must be understood as referring to this hymn that was composed of these six psalms. After the Passover lamb had been eaten, Christ recited this hymn with the apostles as they observed this customary rite. Even the present-day Jews who do not have the Passover lamb still chant this hymn with great devotion during the night of the Passover, using only unleavened bread. So, in this commentary, Pablo tells his Christian audience of a rabbinic practice, the singing of the Hallel in Passover. But this information becomes of dramatic importance, as Pablo claims that he can read it back into the stories of the New Testament, shedding new lights on practices and beliefs on the practices and beliefs of Jesus and the apostles, and in this case, the story of the Last Supper. Now, of course, such a reading would have to assume not only that the rabbinic teachings went all the way back to the Second Temple, but that Jesus and his disciples themselves were living not as biblical Jews, but according to these rabbinic traditions, the same traditions that were preserved in the Talmud and that are still practiced by Jews in their synagogues. At the beginning of the 15th century, this was a rather radical and potentially even dangerous assumption for a Christian to make. But from a Jewish perspective, this would have been almost self-evident, as Jews were regularly imagining Jesus in a Talmudic scene. It was this basic assumption that was deriving Duran's systematic analysis of Christian principles as distortions of rabbinic practices. In fact, when he was going through the story of the Last Supper in Matthew, he came, and when he came to the verse, the same said verse, that told of the hymn that Jesus and his disciples sang, he simply translated it from the Latin into the Hallel. We can read it. This is how he interprets the passage, the underlined what the actual text of Matthew says. So you can see that Duran put this comment saying that this is according to the custom of Israel, that what we're reading here is actually a quite common practice of a seder. And then when he paraphrases what the scripture says, he said, and then it is said that after they finished chanting the Hallel, they went to the Mount of Olives, where he was captured. So what I was trying to show here today, that the same thing that in the hands of Duran became a tool for an anti-Christian polemic, in the hands of Pablo, could become into a sensational discovery of what Jesus actually chanted in the Last Supper. Both these scholars of Jewish training were reading in the New Testament traces of rabbinic ideas. However, for Duran, these findings served as proof of the historical distortion of Christianity, Pablo tried to channel them into new forms of Christian knowledge that would allow, in turn, to expand the boundaries of Christianity and to include rabbinic elements that were often considered illegitimate. Okay, so with this, I conclude the first step, the premise, don't worry, not the first step of this lecture. The first step of the study that I'm currently conducting, and that is, at least to my understanding, that these new notions, these new ideas, are emerging from this very intensive scene of Jewish, Christian, and Converso interactions at a time where the boundaries of these religions and the boundaries of what Converso can do or cannot do, both whether if they see themselves as Jews or they see themselves as Christians, are not yet strictly defined. And people as Duran and Pablo can try each to pull to his own direction. And what this couple shows is we have here two prominent Jewish scholars of a very similar profile that undergo conversion at the same time, but obviously have very different feelings about their new Christian identity. Though legally, and this is the point that I was trying to stress in the first part, Duran was completely a Christian. We have a letter. We have a letter from a 15th century Italian humanist, Marco Lippomano, that corresponds with a friend in Spain, with a Jewish friend in Spain, and they get into this argument about what's going on between in Spain and generally some kind of a religious polemic. So one of the things that the Christian humanist, the Christian Hebrew, says, he start counting the famous converts, and you can see that for him he counts Duran and Pablo de Santa Maria together. So the idea that is completely obvious for us as historians, that we take Duran's work, what he does in the Disgrace of the Gentile, what he does in Maaseh Fod, as part of an ongoing Jewish tradition, it's not exactly so. He writes in a very particular circumstance these ideas, and what we can see that both of these men have to conduct some kind of a double polemic. That is, and outwards towards the rivaling community that they are trying to pull people from there, that is to run against Christianity and Pablo against Judaism. But at the same time, they have to conduct this polemic inwards, in order to their own, to the communities that in which they want to belong, in order for them to accept their new identities. And therefore these two converts articulate two of the far-reaching criticism, each for his own community, not the rivaling community, that is Duran for Judaism and Pablo for Christianity. So as we know, eventually these ideas or this converso ideology will not prevail in the Iberian context, in the sense that it will not prevent the persecution of converts. That is, if Pablo had this great project of trying to draw an inclusive Christian identity that would be able to include Jewish elements without them being seen as heretic or dangerous, it obviously failed. As the means of persecution of converts later show, and we can see that in the context of the Iberian Peninsula, some of his ideas cannot be repeated later. I mean, they would be considered extremely dangerous to pronounce, especially those regarding the rabbinic origins of the Talmud. But what we can also see that his writings are becoming huge bestsellers in the second half of the 15th century, mostly outside the Iberian Peninsula. The Scrutinium is copied in more than 100 manuscripts and printed 6 times only in the 15th century. The Adationes is copied in almost 40 manuscripts and printed for 25 times in the 15th century alone as part of biblical editions. So while these ideas are or at least part of them, because other part of them still carries on in the peninsula, but while these certain elements of these ideas are no longer viable for converts to hold in the Iberian Peninsula, very quickly they are spreading throughout the continent, going to centers to other centers of Christian scholarship that find great interest in them. So just to give the final note, if we go and this is what I'm actually doing right now, if you study the first generation of these new Christian Hebraists of the 15th century, the late 15th century and the early 16th century, you can see that these writings of Pablo de Santa Maria or his ideas that were transmitted through other writings are the crucial building blocks of their justification to do what they're doing. The famous controversy, the Reuchlin controversy, the Reuchlin affair about the Talmud, that begins in 1517 when Reuchlin needs to write a recommendation of whether to burn or not burn the books of the Talmud, and gets him into that in so much troubles and arouse this controversy that captivates the entire continent about these issues. If you read what Reuchlin is saying in his outrageous recommendation, this is in the second decade of the 16th century, why the Talmud should not be burned, you see that his main source, that his main explanations are drawn from the work of Paolo da Santa Maria. At first he doesn't admit it, later when it becomes when it becomes dangerous and he understands that he's in trouble, he's starting to say, well, somebody else wrote it first, or at least his defenders are saying that. But you can see, but it's not only with regard to the controversy of the Talmud. Also in his grammar book, Reuchlin writes the first Latin Hebrew grammar book in 1510. The model for Christian scholarship of the Hebrew Bible that Reuchlin gives is Pablo de Santa Maria. But not only that he gives him as a model, it is also an unreachable model. Because what Reuchlin also acknowledged, being a close reader of Pablo, is that Pablo, being a convert, sets a standard of linguistic learning that is unattainable but by Christians who weren't raised as Jews. So it's not only that the scholarly ideas themselves are traveling, but also the notions about converts and what the function that converts themselves should fulfill within Christian scholarship and Christian history of salvations are also re-emerging in these circles. If to give another last example, Marcello Ficino, the great the great figure of the Neoplatonic school in Florence, in his on the Christian religion, in the last part he talks about the Jewish origins of Christianity, and he quotes almost ad verbum Pablo's scheme about the role of converts in Christian salvation, including these lists of names that I showed you earlier, that going from Paul to Stephen to Evaristus to Junior of Pomerius to Petrus Alfonsi, but only adding other names as Jerónimo de Santa Fe and Pablo de Santa Maria himself. So this notion of converts having a specific role, or the possibility that one can read scripture on a hermeneutical level that will allow to read spiritual promises, that is Christian promises addressed to a part of Israel that is also fleshly, that is converts. This possibility we can see also coming up in that circle. And this is the kind of very general framework of the dissemination of this converso ideology that I think can be traced and should be appreciated as an important factor alongside the awakening of the Studio Humanitatis and other ideas in the process of reviving the Christian interest in its Jewish history and imagining its own rabbinic history. And that's it.
That the Duran's Hebrew writings were written for conversos, many of whom, as we know from Crescas, were not reading Hebrew, which is why Crescas himself at the exact same time wrote in the vernacular. A detailed Hebrew grammar, such as Masei Eifod, would really not be particularly useful for these conversos. I think, if anything, if he's trying to make an apologia for his conversion and still being Jewish, he's writing for Jews who hadn't converted. So you could say, well, that would encourage them perhaps to convert, but I don't think so. I think what he's trying to do is say, I'm still part of you, and
I'm like... I wasn't clear enough, I guess. This is exactly what I said. Duran is writing this the introduction of Masei Eifod to the Jewish community to which he wants to be a part of. Still be a part of, exactly, in order to read, to try to make a room for someone as himself, who can't practice Talmudic, halachic study anymore, who can practice commandments, but wants to argue to this imagined or real Jewish community that he's trying to be a part of. There is a new field, or there is another field of scholarship that is as Jewish as your fields of scholarship that I cannot practice, and that is that what I'm saying.
And the polemics, I mean, I must have misunderstood, but I thought you said that they were being written to conversos.
The polemic, not Masei Eifod. You mean
I thought you said his whole literary.
Well, of course. I mean, this is what I'm trying to say. These kind of divisions, I'm not sure that they are helping us. I mean, is Pablo a converso? of course that Pablo is a converso. Is he reading Hebrew letters? Of course he's reading Hebrew letters. He's writing Hebrew letters. He's polemicizing in Hebrew with his Hebrew correspondent. So is a letter like Duran is...
Yeah, but he's a very learned person.
So all right, but of course, but we're talking about... Well, of course that all of the my presentation and study is intellectual history. It deals with trends in people, not necessarily with the simple converts who had to decide if they continue to practice saying hiding or not. But of course that in this level and again we have a subgenre of letters, of Hebrew letters, that converts and Jews are writing to each other. It's not the only one, of course, between Yeshua Lorki and Pablo de Santa Maria upon his conversion. Then later on by Francis de San Jordi. And so, of course, also converts are supposed to read it.
And just one little other. I'm not sure that they understood the Hallel, saying Hallel as being a rabbinic practice.
Who?
Either Pablo or Duran. When it said he sang the hymn, they just assumed that this was a biblical practice of reading the Hallel. Mm-hmm. I mean, we know that it's a post-biblical development. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that. I mean, he didn't say they sang Chag Gadol. Mm-hmm. He said they sang Hallel. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying is to say that he's sort of making Pablo is making Jesus into a rabbinic Jew. At least on that example, mm-hmm. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
He does draw a connection. He says, as Jews practice today,
mm-hmm.
and put them all on the same continuum. Yeah.
And
so even if historically speaking, we're not talking about Hallel as being a hallmark of rabbinic practice in the second century, as far as he can see it from his point of view, they're on the same continuum. Jews are practicing the same sort of practice till this very day next door to you.
That sounds good.
But yes, well, just a quick response. If we start from Duran, in Duran's reading, critical reading of the New Testament, it is clear that he sees their rabbinic practices because he refers to a variety of rabbinic sources that depicts these kind of practices that he now reads in the New Testament. So there isn't any question, and if we assume, and this is what I think we should assume, that Pablo and Duran have about the same kind of knowledge about this, and Pablo is probably reading the Disgrace of the Gentiles as well, so he has no doubt that this is a rabbinic. And the second thing is, of course, from the Christian perspective, it is clearly not a biblical practice. Why does the Jews in the synagogue sing until this day the Hallel? It's not written nowhere in the Torah. So where does this practice comes from?
No, but in Psalms, it still is.
Yes, but it's but where's the tradition? Okay.
Just a short comment about the public, both were addressing Duran and Pablo de Santa Maria. In their generation, most converts were first generation converts. So we're not talking about people who lost all Jewish identity and Jewish learning that they had before. So that's one point. The other point, of course, they're addressing the learned circles of the converts. And simple people didn't participate in this discussion at all because they didn't have the knowledge to engage in such a discussion. So in any case, we're talking about first generation converts and not people who forgot completely or had no knowledge of the Jewish roots. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
כמו שאמרת, בחוץ שלי הוא נספח על מולכים מרכזיים בספר הכוזרים בתרגום יהודה אבן תיבון, השליחה והלב והסכונה והעניין האלוהי. והקטע כולו הוא בעצם בעיקר עיבוד על פסקה מסוימת בספר כוזרי, שזה מאמר רביעי להפחת ג' עכשיו, המאמר הזה הוא מאוד מאוד עמום מבדה מסוימת ולא פלא וחשוב גם, זה לא פלא שהוא קצת שהמחקר המודרני אמר את זה, הפירוש של הפסקה המסוימת הזאת היא נסתבת באמת בלב של הפמבאים, במוקד של פרשנויות שחולקות אחד על השנייה. אם יהודה הלוי כל כך מדגיש את המהות הייחודית של היהודים, באמצעות המונחים האלה שהתרגומים שלהם בעברית, הקליפה, הלב והסגולה בעניין האלוהי, ואז כמו שאפשר אולי להבין, או שהרבה פרשנים וחוקרים מבינים שבחב גימל, אותו מאמר רביס לחב גימל, בעצם הוא מדבר על זה שבאחרית היומים כל העמים והדתות יהפכו לעץ אחד, ואז יש למהלך אוניברסלי של התכנסות לגמרי יהדות, אז זה בעייתי, מאוד בעייתי, ועל זה יש חלוקות הדעות. עכשיו, איך זה מתרגם קצת כאן הבעייתיות, המתיחות הזאת, לתוך מה שדורן אומר, והשאלה היא באמת, אם הוא מתחיל ומדגיש את הייחודיות של היהודים, שיש להם איזו מהות ייחודית שלא נעלמת גם בזה שהם ממירים את דתם, ואז אחר כך הוא ממשיך ואומר בסוף, זה הפך להסיר שער העמים ולאמונותינו לראות העניין האלוהי, אז שאלה איך מבינים את העניין הזה? כי אם יש כאן חזרה אוניברסלית של כולם ליהדות, אז שגם הנוצרים שלא הביאו את דתם או דתות אחרות יחזרו ליהדות והגיעו ליהדות באיזשהו מהלך אוניברסלי, אז מה החשיבות בכלל שכל הדגש המיוחד על המהותיות של היהודי שלא משתנה? ואז אפשר אולי איכשהו לחשוב שבאמת אולי הפסוק הזה להחזיר שער העמים ולנותנו בהקשר הספציפי הזה דווקא בצורה עמומה ומכוון, אבל אני מכוון דווקא לקהל של המומרים, שהם יחזרו, זה לא בהכרח איזה חזון אחרית הימים שכל העמים חוזרים, מגיעים לאמת של היהדות, אלא חזרה דווקא של ציבור המומרים, שיש לו, להיות שהוא נמשך, והמהות הייחודית שלו, הוא נמשך בהכרח לחזור אל אותה מהות, ולהתגשם בתוך תהליך היסטורי.
זאת אומרת, של להבין, אתה מציע לקרוא את את להחזיר שאר העמים, שאר העמים כמה שמתייחס בעצם ל...
אני פשוט...
לא, כי זה יכול להיות, כי אני...
יש כאן
מתח,
יש כאן...
מתח
הזה הוא גם נמצא בספר הכותל, יש כאן מתח שהוא כאילו מתח ואני מפרשים את הקטע המסוים הזה שסעיף חב גימל בצורה שאומרת שההבדל המהותי בין עם ישראל והישראלי לבין הגויים לא מתבטל באחרית היומים, לעומת הרבה פרשנים ורופאים אחרים שחושבים שהכוונה כאן כן
טוב, גם ברור גם שהוא לא קורא, הוא קורא את הכוזרי כבר דרך הרבה מאוד שכבות גם של אנשים, של פרשנויות, זאת אומרת, זה לא בכך.
אבל המתיחות הזאת היא כאן, בולטת גם בקטע הזה.
כן, לא, אני חושב שזה אפשרי, כי גם מה שלא נמצא פה זה שלפני זה, בעצם לפני שהוא מתחיל, הוא קורא את ארנינו גויים עמו, כמתייחס בעצם למומרים, זאת אומרת, ולא, יש לו מקום שבו הוא מתייחס לגויים ועמו, לביטוי שנמצא בדברים 32-43, כביטוי שהוא ביחד, זאת אומרת, גויים ולאומו, ביחד מתייחס למומרים. אז יכול להיות ש... זאת אומרת, זה הצעה מתקבלת על הדעת, זאת אומרת...
אמנם מדובר שם על עץ ועל יונקות
קשר פה לספר הכוזרי מאוד בולט, צדק. היות ואלה הטקסטים הראשונים שאני מניח, אתה יודע יותר טוב מהם, שמונגשים למומרים. סיפור הדברים הנוצרי, סיפור התורות הראשונות של ישו, שמגיעות, ואנחנו מוצאים את הדברים האלה גם בספרי התקופה, זאת אומרת, למשל, הזרע חוזרים פעם אחר פעם אחר פעם, במיוחד, לפחות מכיר את זה, במאה התקופות למומרים, האם יש פה ניסיון להתכתב עם הדבר, ולנסות לתת איזשהו ביטוי לזה בתוך הטקסט שלו?
יכול להיות, ויכול להיות גם, אני חושב שדני כתב שהוא חושב שכבר בכוזרי בעצם מתכתב עם פאולוס, עם המשל, אבל אז אני אומר, יכול להיות שהוא מתכתב עם זה, ויכול להיות שפשוט שתי המסורות האלה קוראות כל הזמן את אותם דימויים מאז הרגע הראשון שהן צומחות מאותו מקום, ולכן זאת אומרת, קשה לדעת באיזה מקום השכבות נפגשות אחת עם השנייה, אם עכשיו הם נפגשים או שפשוט הם חופרים עוד שכבה למטה ומוצאים שוב פעם שניהם את אותם דימויים ומוצאים את אותם דימויים. אבל זה ברור שהוא מנסה פה לקחת דימויים שהם קיימים והם מוכרים, זאת אומרת, הוא צריך ללכת למקומות שכולם מסכימים עליהם, לשירת משה, שזה הנבואה הכי חשובה בשנים האלה שמתייחסת לגאולה המתקרבת של עם ישראל ושל החזרה שלו, וללכת לקרוא מומרים דווקא לתוכה, וללכת למשל הזה, משום שספר הכוזרי הוא להיט גדול בשנים האלה, בהרבה מאוד חוגים, עם הרבה מאוד סוגים של קריאות שונות שלו, זאת אומרת, אלגוריות או לא אלגוריות, אבל זה דימוי שהוא, זה דימוי שכולם יודעים במה מדובר, לפחות בקהל שלו.
כן.
Three comments. I will try to be brief as possible. First, you gave a fantastic lecture, path-breaking, and I think that hopefully you will contribute a lot, both concerning humanism and concerning Converso phenomenon. When you ended, I wanted to say bravo, you know. Your style reminds me Wagner, you know, you we have the sensation that the opera is ending, and no, it's in the always crescendo, never ending, you know, and fantastic, Yosi. I have now two now contents, comments concerning the content. The first one is typological. I think that you show that this is part what I used to call a converso Paulinian moment, and it is one of those Jewish Paulinian moments in Jewish history. That is, when persons being Jews or philo-Semitic non-Jews, they discover the Jewish roots of Paul, and they negotiate it, and they interpret it in different ways, being during in 15th century or in 19th century Europe. And this led me, for example, to Prophet Duran. Yes, no wonder if Prophet Duran is quoting Yehuda Alevi, that it is, of course, a kind of anti-Paulinian, of asymmetric Paulinian metaphor of the olive tree, in the sense that Duran is endorsing not a Judeo-Christian Christianity like Pablo, but a Christian Judaic Judaism in this time, telling we have to look not at the tree but at the seed. At the same time that, according to Paul, there is a scandalous as mystery how humanity is redempted through the going from down to the top. In Prophet Duran is on the contrary. We are going back from the branches to the roots, to the seed. And this has to do with, let's say, Franz Rosenzweig and other people who, just before hesitating to convert to Christianity, they were bewitched by Yehuda Levi, because Yehuda Levi is calling to return to the seeds. And this is also, I will say, a Jewish Paulinian voice, who is a counterpoint to Pablo Santa Maria Judeo-Christian Christian voice. And I think that you are, what you are showing here is very important, not only historically but typologically and theologically. And finally, a comment, maybe I am not sure
that we can put together two different things you elaborated so brilliantly here. One is the function of Jewish origins in theme of salvation history. One thing is to be Paul and Evaristus and Pablo Santa Maria, because they were illustrious Jewish person to convert it into Christianity. That is, those people, they gave their Jewish blood in the history of Christian salvation. And the other is to speak about Hebraism. That is, what it is your cultural contribution. And I think that those things are not necessarily the same, to claim, well, the converted Jews, they are important to the Christianity because they have the knowledge, and the other things, they are contributing to the history of the salvation because they are Jews, because they came to Judaism. And maybe one of the proofs, and I am ending, is when you know very well, when Pablo Santa Maria dedicated his interpretation to his son Alonso de Cartagena, he said to Alonso, well, we have here a treasure, you have to know that we are come from the Levites, but he never educated or tried to educate his son to become a Hebraist. Never. Alonso was a great Christian scholar, a great Christian theologian, but never a Hebraist, and I don't think that for Pablo was so important that his son will be an Hebraist, because for him what it is majorly important here is to join the salvation history. That's all.
Okay. Well, I agree that these are not the two things. I'm starting with your last point. I agree that these are not the same things. I did try to make a distinction that there is, you can, and surely if you try to follow these writings and the reception of these ideas, you start to see how they split into very different kind, they're being interpreted very different in different eras and different scenes. I think that in the case of Pablo de Santa Maria, and of course I am biased, his work is so rich of images and ideas that you have everything in it, of all sorts. That is, converts are essentialists because of their linguistic proficiency per se. At certain points he speaks about it, and other places, in other contexts, when he speaks of things, converts are important, regardless to their linguistic and historical understanding. And yet, having said that, and connecting to your first point about Paulinian moment, and I'll ask you, can you think of such a Paulinian moment prior to the period that we're talking about, that is the Converso crisis? Because late afterwards we are recreating such a, and yes, of course the time, yes, of Paul himself.
Yes, I know Paul himself.
Yeah, all right.
No, and the Ebionites and the Judeo-Christians, sorry for telling that, during the fathers of the church, of the primitive church, there is a Paulinian moment.
Okay. No, because I think that putting this together, as I showed, Pablo speaks of Paul in the term of a Converso scholar. And in the term of some, I mean, if you look at the list of the people whom he lists, Petrus Alfonsi, Abner of Burgos, all of them are characterized by the fact that they have wrote apologetical works that transmitted a Jewish knowledge into Christian thought, what we often call anti-Jewish polemics. And I think that Pablo reads much of Paul's epistles as the writings as writings of a rabbi who reads the Old Testament through the knowledge of a rabbi, or as Pablo imagined what a rabbi would know. And because when you feel when you follow the commentaries of Pablo's on Paulus, and just in that same commentary, in that same introduction that you noted, Pablo is making a point that is far from being obvious at that time, that Paul is first of all the most important commentator of the Old Testament in the Christian world. This is an insight that in modern scholarship has been revived only 20 or 30 years ago, that actually Paul is doing in his epistle, he's writing a commentary on the Old Testament. And Pablo completely acknowledged it, because he see the patterns of images, the patterns of reading certain passages that he knows from rabbinic scholarship that goes back to Second Temple Judaism that Paul was a part of, and he sees these patterns, and he completely recognizes Paul as a biblical scholar, and as a scholar who has a sort of rabbinic education and can give Christians better understanding of how the Gospels and the Old Testament fits together. So in that sense, I think that Pablo makes a double contribution to this kind of formulation of Paulinian moment, of the idea of a Paulinian moment, because he has, in certain points, he has an understanding of Paul that again reminds us only of what we see in the past last decades in the Pauline study, the turn of Pauline studies who starts to read him in that fashion.
I will suppress my own comment. Chaim.
Okay, so I want to join those that claim, although I can't do it in the way that he did it, which I found it very interesting, and I'd like to add to what Nadia began to say. I think you put your finger. What's fascinating is I think you put your finger on the dilemmas that face first generation converts, because as you yourself said, and I think that's correct, that as the Pablo's writings became very, very popular and were spread, but I don't think that they were spread because of the dilemmas that that caused him to write. They were read differently. They were read for different purposes, and I found that fascinating. I found it fascinating that he mentions in the list of converts talking about Pablo, who have contributed so much, Avner of Burgos, whose Christianity or whose concepts of Christian doctrine are, let's say, not very Christian, right? In other words, and it's his own Christianity rather than any sort of Orthodox Christianity. And what you just said in your response just now, where you talked about we talk about him as bringing Jewish knowledge into the Christian sphere. I think that probably explains why Pablo mm-hmm. actually includes him in this list, because of what he does in the way of bringing a Jewish knowledge. But you know, I'm involved in this. There's a translation of the Gospels into Hebrew. The first complete translation of the Gospels into Hebrew occurs more or less at this time, and the only manuscript we have of the translation, and again, it's only one manuscript, which we know is a copy of the original, gives us no clue as to the author or to the context or to the who the translator was. Well, the context, I think, no, come back to the context. We have no clues as to who the author was, and I think the way you put your finger on that first generation converts, I think that translation as well reflects that first generation of converts. And what's interesting is it's never used afterwards. Why would that? And it's that first generation who are trying to use the Gospels to try and make sense of their own identity, and therefore there's a need of a translation. But that need sort of disappears after that first generation. And just one other small thing, there's a work called Hoda'at Baldin, which Danny has referred to, and I've written a little about.
You wrote
about it as well, which in a way is almost the reverse, right? But again, I think reflects this fascinating context where you have the story which is behind it, and the story which is in the introduction is of a bishop or an archbishop who's living secretly as a Jew and who then, who of course can't reveal his identity because, or can't reveal that he's convinced by the truth of Judaism because, well, for reasons that are obvious, he can't sort of reveal that. But what happens in that work is that the Gospels are used to prove the truth of Judaism. Right? So the person who writes the work uses the Gospels to prove, not in a very clever way, but that doesn't matter, right? But he uses the Gospels to prove the truth of Judaism. Again, we have that this very amazingly interesting and convoluted first generation attempt to deal with questions of identity and religious boundaries. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I also wanted to say thank you because it's a very good talk. I come to it from a complete perspective of complete ignorance, so I appreciated the way you could speak, obviously both to the experts, but also to people who don't know anything about it. And so, something you said close to the beginning, I'm not sure if you said it or if it's the way I heard it, but there was some comparison, I think, with reference to Dura implied between the condition of being a convert and the condition of exile. Again, I'm not sure if that's what you said, but it seems like maybe both can be seen as conditions of, first of all, difficulty and struggle and many challenges. Also what you said about the emphasis on studying above and beyond, which Durant spoke about, above and beyond other practices that maybe are not so possible in fear of exile, change of place and condition. And above all, the temporariness of these two conditions, as Durant, if I understood it correctly, was thinking about it, being a convert is in a way a temporary condition. There will be a return to Judaism, or at least the heart is still looking in that direction. So I wanted to ask you if that's a valid comparison, if there is such a trope like that.
What, of exile and conversion?
Because especially with exile being such an important theme in Jewish history, is it possible to think of conversion as a form of exile that also offers the possibility of return?
Well, I have to think about it, but in the case of Duran, the issue of exile is not a metaphor, is a part of the Deuteronomic history of Israel, that is of sin, the break of the sin, exile, and later words redemption and return to the land. And what Pablo is trying to do is to insert the issue of converts into this very general scheme that is completely accepted on his Jewish in his Jewish circles. That is what he's trying to. So he finds places in scriptures where it is said that in past captivities there were sins here or someone idolized there, and he says, well, these are converts. These are converts just as we are converts here in this exile, and just as they were saved, just as all Israel was saved from the captivity in Egypt, although much of them followed the idols of the Egyptians, and just as all of Israel was a part of the seed of Abraham that was redeemed when the return to Zion from Babylon, so will happen here. But this, of course, does not mean that what you're suggesting, that conversion becomes that exile becomes also a metaphor for conversion, is not true or possible. I just have to think of examples for that.
So I want to join in the compliments. I enjoyed it very much. It was very stimulating. And you presented two very powerful intellectuals. And obviously, within a certain elite, they have an impact. People quote them way, way later, more than a century later, and so on. And my question actually goes to what, some extent, to what Chaim was talking about when he said first generation. I want to understand if the ideas trickle down and have any kind of social impact within that first or second generations after, when they're alive and then immediately afterwards. In other words, is there any translation of these powerful ideas mm-hmm. into social behavior, social entities? Do they actually have disciples, movements, and so on?
In the case of Duran, it's harder to me to refer because I don't know much about his successors. But in the case of Pablo, first of all, and this relates to several of the comments here. Pablo, although being a remarkable scholar and intellectual, was also a man of who was part of the world. That is, his term as the Bishop of Burgos and even earlier in Murcia, but especially in Burgos, was characterized by a very devotional practices in the everyday practices of the church. That is, he initiated reforms. Several reforms. He initiated changes of practices in the cathedral itself. He was in constant tensions with local clergy because he was trying to educate them in certain ways and force them to abide to certain standards that he was. And there is much more to do with this regard, because it will be fascinating to see with what I until now haven't seen, if someone in this activity that Pablo has done, that is the ceremonies that he institutes several ceremonies that are particular to his cathedral and particular to his local monastery, that he was very close to and where he was buried, that for them he asked for a special permission from the Pope. So he involves in a very intensive way in practical and popular practices, not for conversos at all, for all Christians. Mm. Now, I'm not in a position right now. I haven't seen something in the few materials that I've tried to see that says anything specifically that can be related to a converso identity in that sense. It's just a very high standard learning of Christian learning. Of course, you can find things if you start to make a very wide connection between everything that relates to Mary and to Judaism, because there's a lot of Marian devotions. But you can find these kind of devotion. I mean, it's hard to establish a case that these are things that can be specifically related to converts. Now, as specifically to converts of later generations from his family and beyond, as Dov said, his son and neither of his son become something of an ebraist. So unless you take this kind of 19th, 20th century ideal of Jewishness as being just devoted to scholarship in large, which his family was, so it's hard to point at these kind of lines of continuity. However, when the issue of converts become politically charged, and that is converts starts to face accusations and suggestions of discriminations against them starts to emerge, as we know in 1449 around the Toledo Rebellion, then you can see when they need to articulate a defense on their Jewish identity, then you can see a flow of arguments from the writings of Paolo de Santa Maria into several of these works that were written, both with regard to how you imagine the role of Israel within the church, and both as to the status of converts or of descendants of converts in Christianity. One of the interesting discussions that emerges in that scene in the half of the century is the question of neophytes. That is, this the converso apologetic, the descendants of conversos, are starting to make are pushing to make a legal distinction between neophytes and conversos, basing on the idea that a Jew never, the first Jews who joined Christ were never neophytes. So there are ideas that you can link to what Pablo is doing that reemerge, but it's hard to put them in a in a social net that understand how they transpire.
Yes, I would like to end the discussion regarding something that you said before about Hebraism and learning the Jewish, learning the Hebrew from converts. I would like to mention a quote from Medricha, who says that those who were recently born in Christ, which means converts, and he here wants to respond to people who are criticizing him, as I teach them, they teach me. And that is Nebricha, who is writing much, much later, and he was probably influenced by these ideas. So it is worth really looking more into it.
Yeah.
האמת שהשאלה שלי, אפשר הרבה פה?
שלום.
דומה קצת לממשיכה את השאלה שנמרוד הציג, אבל אני ככה חושבת שזו תופעה נורא נורא מעניינת, התופעה הזו של הדור הראשון, והדור הראשון של המומרים במובן הזה דומה להרבה תופעות, אפשר להסביר אותו להרבה תופעות חברתיות אחרות שאנחנו מכירים של דור ראשון, אני חושבת למשל, דור ראשון של משכילים, או מה שאנחנו קוראים היום נגיד, דטלשים, נכון? כאילו הילדים, הבעיה זה תמיד שהילדים של הדטלשים הם לא דטלשים והילדים של משכילים הם לא בהכרח ואני מנסה לחשוב מתוך מתוך המודל הזה שהצבת של שני המומרים האלה שבאמת יש להם איזה קיום מורכב ומאוד מאוד דיאלקטי ואיזושהי הבנה מאוד מאוד רחבה של המקום שלהם בעולם אם יש לך מחשבות, זה לא בהכרח מתוך המחקר, אם יש לך מחשבות לגבי קודם כל המודעות של האנשים האלה לסוג הקיום הייחודי שהם מייצגים ואם אתה חושב שאפשר להמשיך את הדבר הזה, זאת אומרת אם הדבר הזה הוא בהכרח, האם העובדה שהאנשים האלה הם דור ראשון זה הכרחי לסוג כזה של קיום דיאלקטי או שאפשר באיזשהו אופן לשמר את הדבר הזה, אם יש איזה מודל שהם מציגים שיכול באיזשהו אופן לעבור גם לדורות הבאים, זאת אומרת לייצר איזשהו קיום שהוא יותר מורכב של המראה.
תשובה מצחיקה, פילו מאלכסנדריה. שהוא דור ראשון, של מי, של מה, אבל הפך להיות אבות כנסייה בקיסריה ואחר כך ברנסנס שוב. וחלק מן השאלות, איך משתמשים בו להבנת הכתובים, להבנת המורשת. חלק מהדיון שאתה העלית, איך בולעים את פבלו, בקטע הזה, זה בדיוק גם קיים לגבי פילון, שפעם אחת מגלים אותו בקיסר, עקב מקור מצוין להבין את האמונה המונותאיסטית, ומצד שני, מגלים אותו שוב ברנסנס, וברנסנס מבינים שהוא לא יכול להיות אבות כנסייה.
לא, אבל פילון, אני לא שואלת על ה... איך משתמשים בזה, אלא ממש כתופעה חברתית, אם זה יכול להחזיק יותר מדור אחד
בדרך כלל. טוב, אני לא יודע ואני לא בפוזיציה לענות. לא, אבל אני אגיד, אני דווקא כן אתם מתעניין בכיוונים שפיטר נניח דיבר, זאת אומרת, מה קורה עם הידע הזה? זה מבחינת המחקר שלי שמה שאני מתעסק בו בסופו של דבר, הנקודה הזאת שאנחנו נמצאים בה מבחינתי היא נקודת, הנקודת ההתחלה שממנה אני הגעתי, שאליה אני הגעתי, שפה קורה משהו שאחר כך אי אפשר להבין שמסתכלים על המאה ה-15, מאיפה מגיעים הרעיונות האלה, מאיפה זה צומח, אז התפיסות שהיו המוכרות של כל מיני אספקטים הומניסטיים לא מספקות תשובה מספיק טובה, אני חושב שפה יש איזשהו דרייב שהוא הרבה יותר משמעותי שמייצר את הידע החדש הזה, אבל אני אגיד משהו כזה, שזה גם כן מתייחס לכמה דברים כבר שנאמרו. פבלו בשום מקום אני חושב, בכל המקומות שהוא מדבר על ישראל והתפקיד שלו, הוא אף פעם לא אומר משהו ספציפי, מפורש, על הדור השני. זאת אומרת, התפקיד של המומרים, ופה זה שוב מחוזר לעניין של מה הם מביאים איתם מהיהדות, הוא תמיד מתייחס עד ליהדות, זאת אומרת, על הדור הראשון, על אלה שעברו. זה נכון שבהקדמה יש איזה רמז לזה שגם הבן שלו הוא חלק מההבטחה הזה, אבל צריך לזכור שגם הבן שלו נולד כיהודי ועבר המורה, אמנם בגיל צעיר, אבל חלק, אבל אין מקום שבו פבלו מציג טענה חד משמעית ומפורשת, שאומרת שגם הצאצא של המומר והצאצא של המומר והצאצא של הצאצא הם חלק מאיזשהו משהו, משהו מיוחד. זה יכול להשתמע מחלק מהדברים, אבל הוא אף פעם לא אומר דבר כזה. זאת אומרת, אז אם נלך, אם נלך בכיוון הזה, אני לא בטוח שהוא בעצמו חשב שזה, שזה, שיש התכנות, זאת אומרת, בכלל, לייצר פה איזושהי שושלת של למדנות פנימית, מומרית, אלא ש... אבל גם, אגב, המשל, המשל שפבלו משתמש במשל העץ, שמדבר על זה, שמשתמש, הוא משתמש מירמיהו, שמדבר על שלושה, ארבעה, גרגירים שנשארים בראש, בראש הענף. כן, וזה המשל שמתייחס למומרים שלאורך הדורות מגיעים. הוא מתייחס לתרומה הזאת, היא תרומה של יחידים. זאת אומרת, הוא אפילו לא מתייחס לכלל המומרים כמשהו הכרחי. הוא מתייחס לאליטה של מלומדים שבאופן הכרחי חייבים להגיע מאיזשהו רקע למדני יהודי, כנראה משום שהוא שותף לגמרי להערכות שיש לדורן לגבי אופי הידע, המסורות בהקשר שלו, כן, אבל באופן כללי הידע היהודי, אבל באופן ספציפי אותן מסורות אנדלוסיות של, של חקר מקרא, של פילולוגיה, של, של הכרת, הכרמת המקורות, יש לו הערכה עמוקה באמת לסוג הידע הזה ולמה אפשר לעשות איתו אל מול המקורות הנוצריים, וככל הנראה ההבנה שלו של התפקיד הזה של המומר קשורה באופן הדוק לדבר הזה שהוא מביא איתו, שלא מתקיים בדור השני.
אבל זאת נקודה אוגוסטינית, לא? שהתפקיד הזה של הידע, שבכלל למה...
אוקיי.
למה להשאיר בכלל את היהודים בעולם? זאת אומרת, זה כבר מתחיל להיות...
בהחלט.
אני בהתחלה חשבתי שזה מאוד אופטימי כל הרגע הזה, וזה מה שרציתי להגיד קודם, שיש איזה רגע אופטימי כזה ש... שנראה כאילו ה... בעצם לא חייבים לבחור.
יש קיום שלישי
כזה. אפשר... וזה אולי לא יכול להישאר עוד דור, היכולת הזאת להיות בשני העולמות, ההיברידיות הזאת, אבל בטוב, לא במין מצב כזה של, שכמו שיום טוב ליפמן מילרזן אומר, הפוסחים על שני הסעיפים שהם כמובן הסדר
פייפס,
איך אומרים? שהם הכי, הכי, הכי גרועים מכולם, להפך, הם הכי טובים מכולם. באיזה רגע, אבל בעצם זה הופך להיות למשהו אפולוגטי, לא כל כך
בסופו של דבר. תראה, אם מישהו שם ניסה להציב מודל כזה שזה יאפשר, אגב, זה דואן, זאת אומרת, והוא גם למעשה, אם שופטים את זה בכל כלי, הוא נמצא בסיטואציה הרבה יותר היברידית, כן, הרבה יותר קריפטו, הוא חי כנוצרי ולגמרי מזדהה כיהודי. פבלו עושה מהלך שהוא לפחות כמו שאנחנו יכולים להבין אותו, הרבה יותר צנוע, זאת אומרת, הוא בסך הכל מה הוא אומר? הוא אומר שלחלק שלו מישראל, לזהות שלו כחלק מישראל, יש חלק חשוב בתוך ההיסטוריה, בתוך ההיסטוריה הכנסייתית, ושל הידע הזה יכול להעשיר את זה, זאת אומרת, הם לא בדיוק, זאת אומרת, מקבילים, אבל זה בהחלט נכון שתראו, פבלו את כל הדברים האלה שהוא אומר, הוא צריך להגיד, וזה אגב גם ביחס לאבנר מבורגוס, וזה הגדולה של פבלו כדמות אחת מיוחדת. אנחנו יודעים הרי שמומרים היו עוד קודם לכן, ואם אנחנו מסתכלים על מה שקורה במאה ה-13, זאת אומרת על האופן שבו אנשים כמו פבלו קריסטיאני ואחרים מתחילים להביא קטעים מהתלמוד בשביל להוכיח את התלמוד, אנחנו יכולים לשער, להניח שכבר שם הייתה איזו הבנה על הרקע ההיסטורי המשותף אצל האנשים האלה בין מסורות רבניות לבין נוצריות. אלא שהאנשים האלה, לפחות כאלה שאנחנו מכירים, אף אחד מהם לא הפך בעצמו להיות מלומד נוצרי בעל שיעור קומה שיכול לעמוד בשווה בשווה ולכתוב לעולם הנוצרי מפוזיציה של מלומד גדול. וכל הידע שהם נתנו עבר דרך כל מיני מסננות ומנגנונים נוצריים, סכולסטיים, שעשו בהם שמות, עשו בהם דברים אחרים, שונים ומשונים, הפכו אותם לכל מיני דברים והוציאו מהם את העוקץ ההיסטורי, זאת אומרת, הטענה ההיסטורית הגדולה של השיתוף הזה שממנו זה יוצא. ופבלו הוא אולי המומר הראשון שיש לנו, שהוא גם מצד אחד בעל שיעור קומה בעולם היהודי, אבל גם מגיע להיות מלומד ברמה הגבוהה ביותר בעולם הנוצרי, והוא הראשון שמסוגל לנסח, פה אני מתחבר לאוגוסטינוס, לנסח במושגים נוצריים ולמצוא במקורות הנוצריים את הקטעים ואת המקומות שיאפשרו לו לעשות את זה. ואחד, כמובן שאחד המקורות החזקים ביותר, אם מלקטים את הדברים הרלוונטיים, כי כמובן שיש הרבה מאוד דברים, זה אוגוסטינוס. זאת אומרת, לבנות מכל מיני מקומות שבהם אוגוסטינוס בדיוק מדבר על המעבר הזה, בין היהדות לנצרות בצורה שאחר כך קוראים מאוחרים לא שמים לב או משכיחים, והוא מוציא את המקום, והוא מוציא את המקומות האלה שבהם אוגוסטינוס מדבר על ההמשכיות בין ישראל לבין הכנסייה, ואותם הוא בלקט אותם ושם אותם במרכז, ובעצם מייצר את הטענה המומרית הזאת בתוך מסגרת של אורתודוקסיה קתולית. כי שוב, אני לא הזכרתי את זה, מה שאנחנו ראינו אצל פבלו נמצא לגמרי בתוך לב של אורתודוקסיה קתולית. זה לא איזה תנועת מינות יהודית שהוא אומרת זה הגדולה שלו, זאת אומרת שהוא מצליח לעשות מה שלא הצליחו לעשות לפניו, וגם אחריו יהיה מאוד מאוד קשה לעשות. זאת אומרת, או שתגלוש באמת לאיזה שהם מחוזות שבהם אתה מוציא את עצמך מגבולות האורתודוקסיה, מגבולות האורתודוקסיה האלה.
מה עם פטרוס אלפונסי?
מה איתו?
הוא היה מומר וגם מתקבל בתוך ה...
טוב, אבל פטרוס אלפונסי התקבל קודם כל בגלל הידע המדעי שהוא הביא מהעולם האסלאמי.
אני אומר שזה לא זה לא...
עכשיו בסדר, אבל גם פטרוס אלפונסי, אז אנחנו לא... פטרוס אלפונסי, אנחנו לא נמצאים באותו עולם של אורתודוקסיה, זאת אומרת, בתחילת המאה ה-12, מה שהוא כתב ועד שמישהו קרא ועד שמישהו ידע, הוא לא נמצא באוניברסיטת פריז, הוא לא נמצא במרכזי הידע הגדולים של העולם הנוצרי, הוא לא עומד עין מול עין מול ז'אן ג'רסון בוועידות הכנסיות ומתאבד איתו, זאת אומרת, פטרוס אלפונסי מסתובב בכל מיני מקומות באנגליה וכותב דברים, זה לא, הם לא עומדים לאותו מבחן מבחינה הזאת. כן.
טוב, אנחנו נאלצים לקטוע את הדיון, כי אפשר להתמשיך.
אנחנו לא גומרים את ההלל, אבל כן הולכים לסעודה. אז קודם כל תודה.